over from the Archdiocese on this St. Patrick's Day in New York City. John Cardinal O'Connor. Cardinal O'Connor. Good morning, Cardinal O'Connor.
Good morning, God bless. Lovely day, I miss the man. Great day of the year, be Jesus.
Happy St. Patrick's Day.
Happy St. Patrick's Day to you, eh, Mr. Marg? You're looking good, eh, Mr. Marg?
Thank you.
Almost good enough for an open casket, you flea-bitten buffoon, you be Jesus.
I don't think we need that.
Quick, McCord, the Iron Man's boots are drying. You better get down and start licking before the Iron Man gets mad.
I think that'll be enough.
You sickening toad of you. Why don't you lick this, you drooling disaster, you be Jesus? Will you be marching today, eh, Mr. Marg?
Will I be marching?
Will you be marching with us today?
Well, no, I won't.
That's good, because nobody wants your filthy carcass anywhere near Fifth Avenue today, be Jesus.
Well, that won't be fine.
If you're Imus, get out of me parlor. There's no welcome there for you. And if your name is truly Oorshack, get out of me house, you filthy louse, I'll shoot you in the back. If you're Imus, get out of me parlor. There's no welcome there for you. You're making a snow, you're sniveling bar. If not for Fred, you should be dead. If you're Imus, the morgue is the place for you.
My kid, let me just point something out to you, Cardinal O'Connor. Singing is not your strong suit.
The winning numbers in New York State Lottery is as follows.
We don't care what the numbers are.
The daily number.
All right.
636. Hello, Mr. Marg.
I've almost forgotten. That's why Cardinal O'Connor is here to read the lottery numbers. Primary
today
purpose.
Is the day to set homeless people on fire, beat up queers, and knock over some Jewish tombstones.
No, it's not.
And a big thanks be to God, to New York's Mayor Mussolini. Oh, geez, I mean Mayor Giuliani, geez, God forgive me, for not allowing the gay groups to march in the parade this year.
Fine.
Once again, the only things getting blown on Fifth Avenue today will be the bagpipes, thank God. If you hear bottoms up, don't be alarmed, be Jesus. Though you never know with some of those musicians, be Jesus. Oh, me name is McNamara. Put your penis in me hand.
No.
I just found out last Tuesday there's two homos in me band. Oh, Murphy and Kelly play hide the flute. They're taking it in the can. A credit to Olaimus, his McNamara's band.
That will be fine.
Leave me, speckle face. Go in phone number.
No.
6720.
How did this get out of control?
There you go. We'll pass the beers. Take that, Rosina. Pass this one over to Laurie McNipples, will you? Sorry, your feet. I don't have any marijuana for you this morning.
That's all right.
You can always smoke this, you sleazy little punk, you be Jesus.
That will be fine.
Why don't you get a lip lock on an exhaust pipe, you Jesus? Start sucking that, you sad face, Claudia. A few more of these things and we'll be doing the Irish jig on the young man's chest.
That will be fine.
Shut up, you sound like a fool.
Do we have a what doesn't belong and why yet?
If I ever start to sound a bit like Imus, it's time for euthanasia, sure as day. For he whines, complains, and babbles like me grandma, with never much of anything to say. The picture numbers is as follows.
We don't care about them at this point.
Let me ask you this, I, Mr. Marr.
Yeah.
How can you always pick out the Irishman in a hospital ward?
Uh-oh. Well, you know, we just don't want to know this.
He's the one blowing the suds off of the bedpan disease. Pick their numbers. 3, 6, 7, 11, 17, 18, 20, 23, 29, 31, 34, 46, 59, 62, 64, 68, 72, 76, 77. 80.
Fine.
Which of them belong and why?
All right, which does them belong and why?
Which of them belong and why?
Oh, God.
A, Nelson Mandela.
Nelson Mandela.
B, Idi Amin.
Idi Amin.
C, Tarzan. Which of them belong and why?
Oh, God.
Well, Tarzan.
Round your two-legged anal watch, you be Jesus.
Come on.
Well, all three are African leaders and are currently in secret negotiations to succeed Pat Riley as coach of the hooligan Nairobi Knicks.
Oh, goody.
No, not Jane Goodall, you little dirtbag, you shut up. The answer is A. Nelson Mandela doesn't belong because, unlike the other two, Mandela has an unfair advantage due to his lengthy prison record, be Jesus.
Well, not a great end there.
La, 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 la.
John Cardinal O'Connor here on the Imus-1995-good. So much for sophisticated political comedy here on this hideous program. All right, here now on the Imus in the Morning program from a prison somewhere in Indiana, the former heavyweight champion of the world, Iron Mike Tyson. Good morning, champ.
Good morning, Mr. Chum.
Don't do that.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I heard you're engaged.
Yeah
me too. Tiny gave me a ring last night.
Really?
It was our anniversary. I was flabbergasted. I don't know what to say. We were in a mess hall, and I was eating my meatloaf, and all of a sudden I bit down on something hard, and when I pulled it out of my mouth, there it was. A four-carat solitaire he made a metal shop out of a pop top and a rock from the chain gang. Isn't he romantic?
No.
Hey, I was watching Entertainment Tonight. I mean last night. Yeah. I watched Entertainment Tonight last night. So confusing. Anyway, Mary Hart said that Christy Brinkley broke up with Billy Joel.
That's right.
My prayers have been answered. Move over, little dog. The big black dog is moving in. I don't know if I should send her flowers or just a tape of me singing love songs. I've been taking singing lessons in here. I gotta start thinking about an alternative career because I'm not so sure I'm gonna be in any shape to box no more once I get out of here.
Right.
So I think I could be like a pop singer. Billy Joelson. Oh, mammy, let me sing you a song. I'm the piano man. You know, I've been thinking about maybe being an actor.
Right.
I heard Timothy Dalton don't want to be James Bond no more, so they're going to have a worldwide talent search for his replacement.
Right.
That's me, Mr. Chump, agent 007-36549.
Well, whatever.
Tyson. Mike Tyson. I'd be perfect for that job, Mr. Chump. Think about it. Who knows more about pussy galore than me?
Well,
we got a lot in common, James Bond and me. 007 likes an imported Russian vodka martini, bone dry, shaken, not stirred, with a twist. And I like vodka. He drives fast and fancy cars. Me too.
Yeah.
He has all these gadgets to help him get out of sticky situations.
Yeah.
I have a couple of magazines that make me sticky.
Shut up.
James Bond was a guy who liked to beat up bad guys and make love to beautiful women.
Yeah.
I like to beat up beautiful women and make love to bad guys. James Bond had to fight Blofeld and our job.
Yeah.
I got them beat. I fight jobs every day in the shower.
All right, here now, the former heavyweight champion of the world, Iron Mike Tyson, and the champ is back.
Well, I went away, and nobody really cared how I felt. But while I was in solitary, I couldn't believe who they got to wear the belt. Mike Tyson's back, and there's gonna be trouble.
Hey, la, hey, la, Mike Tyson's
back. All your heavyweights are gonna start to see double.
Hey, la, hey, la, Mike Tyson's back.
I was forced into a title abdication.
Hey, la, hey, la, Mike Tyson's back.
Due to my unfortunate incarceration.
Hey, la,
split decision.
Hey la, hey la, Mike Tyson's back.
I could push him over using just my little pinky.
Hey la, hey la, Mike Tyson's back.
And if that don't work, I'll punch him in there, Mr. Dinky.
Hey la, hey la, Mike Tyson's back.
Jimmy's ring you're wearing?
Mm-hmm.
Gee, it must be great riding with him. Mm-hmm. Is he picking you up after school today?
Mm-mm.
By the way, where'd you meet him?
I met him at the candy store. Turned around and smiled at me. You get the picture?
Yes, we see.
Highway Patrol.
The following is a paid political announcement.
Hello, this is Ted Kennedy. Now that I have effectively already won my difficult campaign for re-election, I would like to apologize for some of the tactics my staff and I employed to ensure that I would continue to represent you, my fellow Bay Staters, in the United States Senate. While there are many strategies for which I should do penance, let me confine my remarks today to my habit of constantly invoking the memories of my brothers, John and Bobby, every time anybody mentioned the issues of crime or gun control. In retrospect, employing the memory of dead people from my past is not all that good an idea. Sort of like walking out onto the political stage wearing a sandwich board that says, brought to you by the Ajax Driving School, as the creature from the Black Lagoon hovers at your shoulder, dripping kelp and holding a briefcase. Be that as it may, clearly my strategies worked. Mitt Romney, my challenger, didn't lay a glove on me, bloody or otherwise. Even though in our last debate I sounded like a hooked on phonics mercy case, I did manage to remain on my feet for an entire hour, the longest I can ever recall standing unassisted without leaning on a lamppost or Chris Dodd.
Yeah.
Yes, a personal best. The fact that I have now locked up my re-election at 20 points ahead of my challenger says less about me than it does about him. For clearly, my day is done. My final legislator ticket was punched many years ago.
Yeah.
How in the name of all that is holy, then, could I defeat Mitt Romney? Let me say this about that. If they refer to Vice President Gore as stick man, then they refer to Mitt Romney as chalk outline man. When you look into those eyes, all you see is the deep space probe, Viking 2, leaving our galaxy. Oh, to be sure, I know. When you look into my eyes, you see Bill Wilson. And I would like to address that, the problem of my physical appearance. Why am I overweight? And why does my face look as though I had been bobbing for fried shrimp? The answer is obvious. I drank Ireland. I chased every strumpet under the age of 25 I could find from Hyannis to Key West. And I had to sit through those Anita Hill, Clarence Thomas hearings more nervous than Marion Barry carrying a case of Colt 45 out of a burning liquor store. You go through those ordeals and see what you look like at age 62.
Yeah.
While we have not yet voted, I say with complete certainty it is over. I have purchased this time today to formally announce my declaration of victory and to give you my heartfelt thanks. And so, let the word go forth from this time and place that those detractors who were so confident that this race would produce some fundamental shift, some kind of great sea change, was that an ocean reference?
Yeah.
It was, wasn't it? Yes, here we go.
It brings a tear into my eyes when I begin to realize I cried so much.
This week is thinking out loud about egregious lapses at the New York Times. Mandy?
Who's running America's paper of record? Reverend Moon? Chuck Knox? I don't know about you, but I've been pretty surprised lately by some things I've seen in the Times. Don't get me wrong, I love the old gray lady.
Yeah.
Why not? I'm old, and I'm gray. But then so's Ronald Reagan, who's now misidentifying his wife, Nancy, as Sonny Bono or somebody.
Shut up.
My point is, I'm afraid that, if you'll pardon the phrase, the times it is a-changing. There's a big concern out there among us still serious journalists, me, Jerry Springer, Kurt Loder, that the traditional press is increasingly tilting toward tabloid journalism. You know, the kind of approach best exemplified by Connie Deep Throat Chung. Connie, who once interviewed Tanya Harding and then became Tanya Harding. Now, hold still, Ms. Gingrich. This won't hurt a bit. Pow. Consider two recent incidents. First was this business with First Lady Hillary Clinton. 11 female journalists joined Mrs. Clinton for lunch. Serious journalists. Ann Landers, Cindy Adams, The Washington Post, Lois Romano. You know, all ladies who've either been aboard Venusian space vehicles or who stand out in their backyards at night holding up signs toward the sky inviting them. Hello out there. We come in peace. Communicate and share your wisdom. And Marion Burroughs of the New York Times was there. A single journalist who you'd swear wouldn't be afflicted with one of those old proverbial inquiring minds. Well, she was. Next day, the Times ran a story under Ms. Burroughs' byline that said Hillary Clinton, mind you, had called herself dumb at that luncheon,
yeah.
Had admitted that she knew about as much regarding health reform as a dropout from a veterinary school, and was either going to have to put a bag over her head or get a ground-up, frame-off, eyes-to-thighs emergency makeover at Georgette Clinger, followed by a pit stop at Dale Carnegie.
Yeah.
It's not difficult to believe that that kind of candor was supposed to be off the record.
Yeah.
10 of our gals got it. One didn't. Yep, Miss Burroughs. Uh-oh. 10 honored Miss Clinton's confidence. One decided to blow it out of the water. Just between you and me, I heard that Miss Clinton called Miss Burroughs a bitch. As though all that weren't enough, hard at its heels followed the Maureen Dowd debacle. I don't know about you, but if I'm announcing in my paper the appointment of a columnist who'll succeed the legendary Anna Quindlen, I think I would have run the item a little higher than under boats for sale. There it was, the notice that the distinguished Maureen Dowd had won the op-ed job, buried on page 18 of section C, alongside a review of the latest incarnation of Tom Snyder, the Not Yet Late Enough show. Yeah. Hang in there, Tom. If they put you on any later, you'll be hosting CBS This Morning with Paula. So there you have it. The ascent of Miss Dowd, buried, ironically, in the Times Living section, while titillating tabloid tattling reposes on page one. Yeah. You know what I'll bet is next for the old gray lady?
No.
Nipple clamps and a plain brown wrapper.
All right, here now on the Imus the Morning program, Bernard McGurk as Maya Angelou.
How y'all doing? Okay, let's go. Sure they feed you, sure they feed you, sure they feed you, the blue-eyed Yankees. Only to degrade, oppress, and call you you bangies. So that's why I do not care if it rains or freezes. Long as I get my check and free cheeses, I will survive. Hey, hey.
That will be fine.
Give me them cheese doodles over here. Damn it.
Then I wonder why I get brutalized in the press.
You bring it on yourself.
I don't care.
They point with pride to the road.
Right here now, the Kanky Freeman and Larry Campbell with Ain't Making Jude Like Jesus Anymore.
Well, a redneck nerd in a bowling shirt was a guzzling Lone Star beer, talking religion and a politics for all the world to hear. They ought to send you back to Russia, boy, or New York City one. You just want to doodle a Christian girl and you kill God's only son. I said, has it occurred to you, you nerd, that that's not very nice? We Jews believe it was Santa Claus that killed Jesus Christ. You know, you don't look Jewish, he said, near as I could figure. I had you lamped for a slightly anemic, well-dressed country nigger. All they ain't making Jews like Jesus sent them on. They don't turn the other cheek the way they done before. And spitting on the floor, Lord, they ain't making Jews like Jesus anymore.
Keep it country, boy. Now.
He says, I ain't a racist, but Aristotle Onassis is one Greek we don't need. And them niggers, Jews, and Sigma Nus, all they ever do is breathe. And wops and mix and slopes and spooks are on my list. And there's one little heeb from the heart of Texas. Is there anyone I miss? Well, I hits him with everything I had right square between the eyes. I says, I'm gonna get to you, son of a bitch. You're spouting that pack of lies. If there's one thing I can't abide, it's an ethnocentric racist. Now you take back that you said about Aristotle Onassis. All they ain't making Jews like Jesus sent them on. We don't turn the other cheek the way we done before. You could hear that honky holler as he hit that hardwood floor. Ain't making Jews like Jesus anymore. Everybody in America now. Ain't making Jews like Jesus anymore. Ain't making carpenters who know what nails are for. Well, the whole damn place was singing as I strolled right out the door. Lord, ain't making Jews like.
Dr. Billy Saul Hargis, God's other son, here this morning basically to castigate you heathen, no-good, bottom-feeding fugitives from the food chain. And you know why? Because after all I've done for all of you low these many years, you continue to embarrass and humiliate me, to taunt me and flaunt me, to kick my raggedy ribbon ass every damn opportunity you get. And the latest may be the worst yet, friend. You buy my damn book, second greatest story ever told by mortal man, and you get me on the bestseller list, the Wall Street Journal, Publishers Weekly, the New York Times, below every kind of lame damn author on the planet. Funk that. Dr. Hargis says, funk that. Jesus says, funk that. We are not interested, my brother and me, in getting on any list in which we're subordinate to some waste of trees written by Danielle Steele, wearing her penis obsession on her sleeve. And just one slot above a tome based on that compelling theme all America wants to know more about, the philosophical abstractions of Australian Aborigines. Excuse me, but funk death. And the mutant pygmy you rode in on, funk death. I'm at number 14 on a 15-place list. Get out of here. You are once again, friends, in jeopardy of spurning a son of God. I could have you people fry. But, friends, it's not too late to turn this situation around. It's not too late for you to make it up to me and treat me with the deference I deserve and knock me about 7 pegs up that list of false prophets. How can you do that, I hear you asking, friends? With an offer fashioned in publishing paradise, you celestial sponges. Now, anybody could extend to you a 2-for-1 offer. 2 books for the price of 1 could jack this sucker up. Ain't one thing unique about that. That's why we're now prepared to present to you people who absolutely don't deserve this kind of benevolence, Dr. Hargis's 2-for-2 offer. Yes, friends, 2 books for the price of 2 books. No, you don't have to thank me now. I'm feeling too humble. You can write or fax me some slobbery note of heartfelt worship, praise, and thanksgiving at a later date. So for those among you who have not yet purchased God's other son, well, in the first place, what's the matter with you? Are you in an iron lug or something? Go to the damn store and buy 2, a primary and a backup. It's just common sense. And for those of you who have purchased God's other son, pipe all that boxcar butt of yours back to the bookstore and buy another copy in order to end Dr. Hargis' shame and degradation. And when you get there, just say, either give me the book or a hemlock cup, anything to make the bastard gesture up. Or can I get an amen on that now?
Nobody wants to play rhythm guitar behind Jesus. Everybody wants to be the lead singer in the band. Imus in the morning.
8:42, best of Imus in the morning.
How about a dozen pansies, Fred? How were you in the paratroopers? I know how he was in the paratroopers. They used to have to push him out of the plane. Did you ever actually...
65.
When you were in the paratroopers, did you actually ever jump willingly out of a plane?
No.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
One day the mailman came in here, and Fred was sniffing him, and he said, I don't like the dog sniffing me.
Uh-oh.
And I said, well, why don't you get outside then? Well, they're all ready to explode.
Curb your dog.
That's the first thing. Keep your dog from sticking his nose in everybody's crotch. That's number one.
Man.
And number two, how nuts are you jumping ugly with a poster worker?
Come on.
Then it'll be Steve and a poster worker. They'll be leading you around that warehouse at the end of a wire coat hanger with a shotgun stuffed in your ear.
Minutes after the hour, this best of Imus in the morning.
Imus in the morning here with my friend Scott Muni, Scotzo.
It's come to my attention that some of the I-Man staff, as well as quite a few of the I-Man's listeners,
took umbrage with what was perceived as vicious and insensitive comments made by me pertaining to the suicide of Kurt Cobain.
Yes, that's right.
I truly regret any pain or discomfort that my remarks may have imposed on those who were offended by them. I meant no respect to the family, friends,
You meant no disrespect.
I meant no disrespect. Right.
Okay, read it that way.
I meant no disrespect to the family, friends, or fans of the late Mr. Cobain, and so I am bound by conscience to say I am truly sorry.
Fine, stop there.
I'm sorry that Kurt Cobain took his own life.
Yes.
I would have, gladly, taken it for him.
No.
I'm sorry he had a lousy childhood. I'm sorry it was only lousy and not hideous and truly abusive. I'm sorry his father just divorced his mother and didn't put lit cigarettes out on his tongue and make him walk around with shards of glass in his shoes.
This is not working.
I'm sorry he felt trapped by his success and never wanted to be rich and famous. I wish he'd have quit the business and given all his money to charity and gone to live in a shack on a beach somewhere and sold airbrush t-shirts for the rest of his life instead of touring and continuing to put out shitty albums. I'm sorry he was never covered with honey and stung by bees.
No, you're not.
I'm sorry that he thought he had to suffer for his art and didn't realize that once he released his first album, we were the ones who suffered. But most of all, I'm sorry he didn't take Eddie Vedder, Duff, all the self-centered puppies from MTV's The Real World, and that ugly dude with the hat from the Zima commercials with him.
How does this help?
What do you mean?
Well, how does this help anything? This is hideous.
This is an apology.
Well, it's not working.
I'm sorry you feel that way. Actually, I'm sorry it wasn't you.
And coming up, more of what we euphemistically refer to as best of Imus in the Morning. This is the Imus in the Morning program. It's 9 o'clock WFAN New York.
Senator D'Amato is on the phone now, Fred, so...
What you tricking again?
Fred, just get off the phone.
I'll give you a...
The Republican Senator from the state of New York, Senator Alphonse D'Amato. Good morning, Senator D'Amato.
He's getting better and better.
Oh, Jesus, I'm going to kill him.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Senator D'Amato, it's always a pleasure to have you on. Good luck tomorrow, and thank you very much.
Good being with you.
Senator Alphonse D'Amato here in the Imus Morning program. Fred...
You sissy.
What do you mean?
Man, you're...
What do you mean?
You weak-kneed wuss.
What do you mean?
Scaredy cat pussy. Why don't you ask him about Ito, man?
Oh, come on here.
Imus in the Morning. Sports Radio 66. WFAN.
You're...
Here now on the Imus in the Morning program, fat, whining crybaby, Rush Limbaugh. Good morning, Rush.
My friends, if I have learned anything during my tenure as the omnipotently obstreperous Obi-Wan of the old guard, it is that our constitutional freedoms are a double-edged sword. Alas, the very same amendment that allows me the right to voice my pristinely perfect political pasquinade is also sadly responsible for the pinko propaganda programming perpetrated by PBS. But unalienable rights aside, anyone who has viewed the latest edition of Frontline, dedicated to my favorite subject, me, should have no problem getting behind Newt Gingrich's plan to disassemble public TV. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised if the backlash created by this televised twaddle caused a unanimous outcry for a vigorous financial expurgation of the parasitic PBS, akin to a hemophiliac shaking off a deer tick. In this pathetic profile, I am painted as an overweight outcast who finds the only comfort and solace in his misfit life within the womb-like insulation of a radio studio, where, unchallenged and isolated from the real world, he reigns pompously supreme. Well, allow me to invoke my personal freedom of speech as I address frontline producers Michael Sullivan and David Fanning. you. Kiss my big, beefy, bellicose butt. I'm on 666 radio stations worldwide, making more money relieving myself in the little conservatives' room during commercial breaks than either one of you do in a year, producing TV documentaries that make a film school graduate student's thesis look like Citizen Kane in comparison. Of course, if I were face-to-face with either Messrs. Sullivan or Fanning, rather than here in the dimly lit confines of the Excellence in Broadcasting Studios, it would be an entirely different story. Right. You can't punch me. I have a note from my doctor. Dilly, 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 dilly. Time for a Salvadorian servant update. Rosa Lopez, the most famous Hispanic since Trini Lopez. There's a distress flag hanging off the antenna of the OJ defense team's low rider, folks. I wonder how the accused must feel watching his counsel shift their strategies from DNA evidence repudiation and racist policemen to a hysterical housekeeper who could stand a little less espresso and a little more Prozac. Did she see the Bronco? Did she not see the Bronco? One thing's for sure, she wishes she were in the Bronco on her way south of the border. After the break... Why, look at that front line. I'll be $25,000 richer. More after this.
Just kick those left wingers out the door. We're mad as hell and we won't take it no more. Just look at the opinion polls. We want that old guy, Robert Dole. I've had it up to here with liberals. We need a president with principles. Not a gigolo with no self-control. Give me that old. Mark those ballots now. Senator, may I borrow your pen? Call him a relic, say he's over the hill. But he's still better than that imbecile Phil. No sex and violence at his movie show. Vote for that old guy, Robert Dole. You'll never see him with a bimbo. Knocking with a $5 hole. Ain't got a prostate, but he's sure got a soul. We love that old guy, Robert Dole. Still like that old guy, Robert Dole. Bubba Clinton's about to lose control. So I'm saying on your radio, give me that old guy, Robert Dole. Bubba Clinton's about to lose control. So I'm saying on your radio, give me that old guy, Robert Dole. We want that old guy, Robert Dole. Bubba Clinton's about to lose control. So I'm here saying on your radio, give me that old guy, Robert Dole. Still like that old guy, Robert Dole.
9:51, Imus in the morning.
But I just said that.
I did just say that, didn't I? What an idiot.
A roof is more than something to top off a house.
Copyright 1995, Infinity Broadcasting, all rights reserved. Imus in the morning is a presentation of WFAN and Westwood One Entertainment. It's just sad.
This concludes the entertainment and revenue-generating portion of your broadcast day. We now return you to the rest of your local programming schedule, an indecipherable embarrassment of broadcasting incompetence that compelled the station to subscribe to the Imus in the Morning program in the first place. The entertainment and revenue-generating portion of the broadcast day, the Imus in the Morning program, will resume tomorrow morning. Check your local listings for time and schedule. For sports scores and sports news, it's WFAN 2020 Sports at the top of the hour, 20 past the hour, and 20 before the hour. That's 2020 Sports all day, every day on the fan. Sports Radio 66, WFAN New York.
WFAN 2020 Sports.
It's 10:01. Good morning. This is Mike Breen.
The following is another in a series of fake political resurrections by billionaire industrialist H. Ross Perot.
Amos, you don't gotta be a rocket scientist to know we got a mess of trouble over there in Kuwait with that goat-humping heathen Hussein. We are dangerously close to being chin-high in a turd tank while Saddam is getting ready to go water skiing. And you know why?
No.
Because as volatile as the situation is over there, we got nothing more over here than a fundamentally ill-equipped commander-in-chief who thinks a bayonet is a little girl from New Jersey. And ICBM is something you say when you're changing a baby's diaper. Don't be lulled into a false sense of security on this deal, Amos. This Arkansas hayseed don't know nothing about warfare.
No.
How could he? Where was he in Vietnam? I'll tell you where. Sitting in the dorm room in his bell-bottoms over there in Oxford, listening to Jimi Hendrix on an 8-track, sucking on a bong full of Panama Red, pretending not to inhale. It's just sad that we don't have a leader in this country who commands the respect of the rest of the world, let alone his own military.
Fine.
You try and tell me Colin Powell's eyes don't roll up into the back of his head every time Bill Clinton tries to initiate some strategic move with our armed forces. It's like Al Michaels telling Dennis Green to run a Statue of Liberty play. Everybody knows Saddam's going to throw a bomb, but Bubba just don't know how to play the nickel D. Besides, I don't believe we should be over there in the first place. Why we should lose American life, one, just so the price of gas don't go up is beyond me. Now, I don't care how much gas costs. Want to know why?
Yeah.
I'm a damn billionaire, that's why. It could be 50 bucks a gallon, and my cat is going to have a full tank of high tests. But if we are going to go over there and draw another imaginary line in the sand, then we better have somebody who can John Wayne Saddam Hussein so he don't John Wayne Bob it us. Somebody who'll get in his face, under his caftan, grab him by the short smellies, and make him turn his head and call. Somebody who's got experience kicking Middle Eastern ass and taking names with no vowels in them. George Herbert Walker Bush. Just like I said about the November elections, let's put the other side in charge and see if they can do any better. If not, well then, I'm your man. Because I can provide the peaceful solution, Amos.
Right.
You know why?
No.
Because I'm a damn billionaire, that's why. I could buy and sell Hussein's army with what's fallen between the cushions of my sofa, Amos.
Yeah.
No need for a clash, because Ross got the cash. That there's a T-shirt.
Yeah.
Might have to get him ready for 96.
Yeah.
I'm going to go talk to your brother about that one, Amos. But in the meantime, thanks again for having me on your show.
Well, made me raise an eyebrow, made my head spin. Can't picture and rather dig in R.E.M. Hey, I'm a king of rock and roll here, son.
All right.
I'm going to have to assume my hearing ain't quite right, seeing as how I'm still dead and all. But that wasn't our favorite CBS anchor doing the news on your program the other day, was it?
Yes.
Damn. What is the frequency, Kenneth? I guess that whole licky deal with Chung Queen just made him full tilt bozo if he's been reduced to doing your show.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, I wouldn't be surprised if that Johnny Cochran fella called Rather as a defense witness, because old Dan definitely hears dogs barking, you know what I mean? I know this may be somewhat of a surprise coming from a man who used to eat fried peanut butter and banana sandwiches covered in sausage gravy, but he makes me feel queasy, man. It's one thing to have an R.E.M. song dedicated to you. It's another to start talking about how much better you like the ones on their other albums. You know, somehow I have difficulty picturing Rather sitting in a lotus position on a tatami mat, incense and lava lamp cranking, smoking a duber and listening to Radio Free Europe. You know what I mean? But then again, I have difficulty picturing my little daughter between the sheets with a high yellow hermaphrodite. You know, Dan's a perfect illustration of how you don't necessarily have to do drugs to act like you're on drugs. Although he did make some mention about chewing tobacco, didn't he?
Yeah.
And from what I understand, the FDA is thinking about a move on nicotine. I'd be in favor of that, son, because then I could finally say there was at least one regulated substance I didn't abuse. Hey, you don't think this new development's going to rattle that fat-faced geek Jesse Helms' cage, do you? That there's a guy who'd like to take the Surgeon General's warning off of cigarette packs because it scares little kids. He'd have tobacco leaves put on the salad bar at Denny's if he could. Now, I can't see him getting behind any White House measure that would make you get a prescription before taking a ride with the Marlboro man, could you?
Well, no.
In fact, I got a little song for Jesse to get out of here on. Go something like this. Well, king-sized man thought I filled the tips. Senator Helms, hey, pop on this, let's smoke. Everybody, let's smoke. Everybody come and take a toke. I got something here to make you choke.
Oh. All right, here now, the Imus in the Morning program. The O.J. Simpson workout tape. Workout, Juice.
Okay, we're going to start off with some upper body. Do a little brisk punching motion. This will hone your shoulders and triceps. Help that golf swing. And one, punch it. Two, punch it. Three, punch it. Four, punch it. And one, say what? And two, you crazy? Talking back to me? Woman, what are you thinking about, huh? Oh, now you crying. Oh, I'm going to give you something to cry about. I'm going to show you some hand isometrics. Help strengthen your fingers, bulk them up a little. You know what they say about men with big hands, don't you? They have to wear big gloves. and squeeze. It helps if you can squeeze something that will provide a little resistance, like a baseball glove or a melon or something like that. I'm using a Raggedy Andy doll. Squeeze. Who were you out with last night? I want some answers out of you, damn it. I'll choke them out of you if I got it. You hear me? You want to breathe? Huh? You want to... always remember you want to breathe. Uh-huh. It's important for any cardiovascular exercise to maintain a steady breathing rhythm. Yeah. Okay, let's do some twists now. Take your left arm, elbow up like you have someone in a headlock. Now bend your right arm the same way and twist your body till your right fist is perpendicular to your left elbow. And pull across in a rapid motion. Yeah. It helps if you hold a pencil or a rolled up newspaper like I have here. And pull, just like carving a turkey. And pull, like carving a couple of turkeys. Yeah. And pull, and what do you mean I sound black? What's that supposed to mean? Yeah, well, I'm gonna cut me some white meat. Right. Stop laughing at me. Stop laughing at me. Damn. I think I got a paper cut. Boy, that's bleeding a lot, isn't it? Anybody have a towel or something I can wipe this on? Well, what do you have? A tissue or socks? Socks? Okay, I guess that I have to do. Here, put these over there by my hat. You know what? Go ahead, just put them in my hat, okay? I'll take them with me having a car wash. That is, if she has the time. She may be going out with another one of her boyfriends. Who knows? I mean, we may not be married anymore, but we're supposed to still be friends, aren't we? Why can't you just put these in the washer when you're washing that tight dress of yours? Can't you do a friend a favor? Is that too much to ask? You were sure doing Kevin a favor that night when I caught you in the couch, weren't you? What were you doing to him that night in the couch? Stop laughing at me! Stop laughing at me! The dog is laughing at me again! Make him stop! AC, make the dog! Kato, get the car keys! I want to go to McDonald's, and then I want to practice my putting, and then I want to fly to Chicago.
All right, here now on the Imus in the Morning program, my fat friend, Rush.
Turning my mighty jaundice eye this morning toward the world of jurisprudence. The sensational case of O.J. Simpson, this year's Rodney King. Well, what do we have here but yet another Negro leading the police on a freeway car chase? Another fugitive from justice, captured live on videotape, attempting to escape from the clutches of the man. And by the way, last I heard, Hertz was somewhat dismayed that the white Ford Bronco was not rented from one of their many Southern California locations. That could have been a 90-minute commercial. You can't buy that kind of publicity. It's yet another example of the continuing decline of American civilization at the hands of the Clinton administration.
Pardon me.
The last vestiges of morality in this country faded away when Simpson's flight from authorities turned into a spectator sport as he made that last end run down the 405. And how we all clicked our tongues at the shameless rubberneckers who parked their cars on the shoulders and overpasses of the highway to watch the sordid display as we rubbernecked from our living rooms while Barbara Walters droned on about the tragedy of it all. See what happens? Redefine the criteria for what constitutes the American family. Allow interracial, even interspecies marriage. And this is what you end up with.
You're an idiot.
A former running back who spikes his wife, does the Raggedy Ann on her lifeless body, and then gathers well-wishers along his escape route like children cheering on the underdog balloon at the Macy's parade. Oh, the humanity. Yes, my friends, it is Bill Clinton who is responsible for this situation, and he should be held accountable.
Oh, yeah.
Not only for the spiritual and moral decline that enabled these heinous events, I postulate that our president may have actually been responsible for the murders himself. Ah, the machinations of the spin doctor. What better scheme than a celebrity double murder to take some of the sting out of the North Korea, Haiti, sexual harassment, whitewater situations? What a way to knock yourself off of the front pages, Enough of a diversion until those bastards can drag another skeleton out of the closet. I can see it now. Hillary somewhere on the grassy knoll of the off-ramp by Knott's Berry Farm, and in the back of her truck, a ski mask with some of the carpet fibers from Paula Jones' apartment stuck to it. That'd make quite the John Grisham novel now, wouldn't it? More after this. Liberals are just like commies. You can't tell them apart. Think they're so progressive when they're all just big bleeding hearts. The hard
hired workers to give money to parasites that they never have to repay. Tell illegal aliens it's quite all right to be on welfare from cradle to grave. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be liberals. Don't let them start programs for social reform. Be narrow-minded to those who don't conform. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be liberals. 'Cause economy crunches with all their free lunches. They're giving the country away. Like government handouts and hidden agendas.
Yeah.
Like dropping trow in hotel rooms with girls of the night. They all feel guilty because they are so privileged and want to give it all up to the hopelessly needy. So if you don't want your young kids being left out, see that they stay to the right. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be liberals. They love homos and Negroes and Hebrews and such. They rob from the rich, think that we have too much. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be liberals. 'Cause economy crushes with all their free lunches. They're giving the country away. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be liberals. Don't let them start programs for social reform. Be narrow-minded to those who don't conform. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be liberals. 'Cause Bubba and Hillary are both prime examples, and they're giving our country away.
Hey, Bubba, sign this for me, will ya?
What's this, Davis?
My NRA membership application.
You're not joining the National Rifle Association, are you? You know, former President Bush just resigned from the NRA.
Yeah, I know. That's why I decided to join.
Davis, the NRA printed a fundraising letter that called the ATF a bunch of jackbooted government thugs.
Oh, they're not jackbooted government thugs?
No. Now, Janet Reno, that's another story. I believe she's worn a pair of boots or two in her day, but the NRA can't be writing stuff like that.
Don't they have the right of free speech?
Well, yes, but that doesn't mean they have a right to yell fire in a crowded movie house.
Could they yell movie in a crowded firehouse?
Honest to God, Beavis, you're a moron.
Hey, check it out. Look at these books I sent away for.
101 Sucker Punches, Kill Without Joy, The Anarchist Handbook. Where did you get these?
The Action Library catalog. I want to be prepared for the inevitable breakdown of society.
Beavis, there's no need for publications like this. Why, it's this kind of thing that breeds senseless violence. Exactly what George Bush was talking about.
Well, then, how about this one?
God's Other Son? That's stupid.
In your shorts, 2020 sports.
The fight that's coming up on November the 4th is a gesture by Mike Tyson to give back to the fans.
A shocking boxing story. A heavyweight fight on free TV. Good morning.
Wow.
Mike Brain with Sports Don King making it official yesterday. Tyson to fight Buster Mathis Jr. on November 4th. Fox will televise the heavyweight bout. One boxing promoter, Dan Duva, was asked to evaluate Tyson's opponent.
Buster Mathis is a short, fat blimp.
A harsh but candid assessment from Mr. Duva, who also has a fight on the 4th. His man, Evander Holyfield, is fighting Riddick Bowe.
That's an HBO fight. Is that a pay-per-view deal?
Pay-per-view.
Why don't they just move it to the 3rd and eliminate all the problems?
That's a possibility.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, that's what you got to do. Probably.
Fight Buster Mathis Jr.
I mean, I could, today, as sick as I am, I could fight Buster Mathis.
Right now, when you walk through that door, you'd knock him out.
That fat little dwarf.
In baseball, Yankees win again, beat the Orioles in Baltimore 5-4. Winning pitcher for the Yankees was the kid, rookie Andy Pettitte, the youngster who's done very well in the heat of a pennant race, and he says his older teammates have helped him out.
I talk to Jack and Coney and Jimmy all the time. I try to talk to them all the time about baseball.
Pettitte says Cone has told him how to get rid of stiffness in the bullpen prior to a game.
That'll be fine.
The Yankees tied for the wild card lead with Seattle, who had the night off. Boston lost.
The world
is an evil place, overrun with violence and destruction, filled with celebrities who butcher their own wives, then boldly proclaim their innocence to everyone, while they pay a dream team of other men to lie for them. Corrupt politicians who steal from the people with shady land deals, or expose themselves to innocent women, or stick their tongues down the throats of female co-workers. Pendejos, cabrones, hijos de puta, Democrats. In an evil world, it is easier to pull the trigger than play the guitar. Easier to destroy than to create. Easier to curse the darkness than to call someone a fat pantalone. That is why I must believe in the legend. The legend of a man who came out of the long shadows of the desert, riding across the mesa, uncommonly tall in the saddle. He was a manly man, one with a muy grande bulge in his trousers. They say he was born with the sign of the tree, three testicles. When I was younger, there were many stories about this masked hero and his quest to find the man who killed his mother and raped his father. But after a while, those old wives' tales just faded away. There are some who say he was killed by the very one he sought to avenge. Others believe he met a beautiful woman, many years his junior, married her, and they both now live with his brother in Santa Fe, making buffalo camisas for the gringo tourists. And then there are those who dismiss it all as just a myth, that he never existed at all. But I know better. I believe in the legend, because I have seen with my own eyes this very man, the man they call Tres Huevos.
Tres Huevos!
Oh, not again.
Out of the night comes a frightening sight. It's the man they call Tres Huevos. Tres Huevos! He's much better than you, for you only have two. The manly man they call Tres Huevos.
In the morning program, the return of Tres Huevos.
Tres Huevos.
It's 26 after the hour here in New York City. Senator Arliss Specter coming up.
10 years ago, on a cold, dark night, there was someone killed neath the town hall light. There were few at the scene, but they all agree that the slayer who ran looked a lot like
Imus in the morning.
Because of his unorthodox
indictment of the American media apparatus by broadcast veteran Walter Cronkite.
Today, the CBSI turns inward for a cold, unflinching self-assessment of the broadcast product to which you are listening at this very moment. Yes, it's time for the annual State of the Program Address, or the Decline and Fall of the I-Man Empire. Yeah. If you happen to tune into the Imus program in recent days, you already have some inkling of what is going on behind the scenes. Subversion, defection, disorder. Yeah. Liesl Denton, the Imus World Headquarters Executive Assistant, quitting the program in a stunning act of treachery. Bernard McGurk, Executive Producer of National Imus Programming, guilty of perfidy, abandoning his post of command and control in the midst of the fray. You heard the pleading cry from an I-Man left uncovered. The cry of, Lou, where's that f***ing Bernard? Can't the bastard stay in the studio for 5 minutes? And Lou Ruffino himself, the head technical engineer for the Imus program, purposely, maliciously placing the program in peril through a laissez-faire attitude that says, in short, if it gets on the air, fine. If it doesn't, it's not my show. I work for a jerk. You know those moments of insurrection well. How many times has Imus been reduced to having to bellow at Mr. Ruffino's clearly deliberate transgressions, forced to employ phrases such as, what was that dead air there, you redheaded dwarf? You couldn't engineer a light switch, little Indeed, having investigated matters as foul as the assassination of President Kennedy, this old, revered, even adored man of letters can say without fear of contradiction, the I-Man faces a conspiracy, a cannibal's cabal, a support staff bent on destruction from within. Charles McCord, belying his purported decades-long friendship with this beleaguered radio icon, ignoring Imus at crucial on-the-air moments, in the vernacular of the business, leaving the son of a bitch hanging, offering no help, saying in so many words, it's your grave, Imus, fall into it. Mike Breen, adding to the chaos, quietly removing valuables from the radio legend's office, a tape here, a CD there, a book, a critical memo, and then pleading wide-eyed innocence. And Rob Bartlett and Larry Kenny, with their hollow declarations of allegiance to the I-Man, as they mock and jeer him behind his back, pointing, laughing derisively, rubbing their hands in glee when this long-suffering servant shares his infirmities. You heard those pitiful petitions for sympathy. My back hurts. I've got a fever. I think one of my legs is shorter than the other. Heart-wrenching. And does he receive compassion?
No.
Rather the bitter retort of an adversary, perhaps Bernard, saying, yes, I-Man, you do have a short leg. Your middle one. Followed by snickers of abject, insolent defiance. Yeah. And so, the state of the program, 1995, imperiled. Don Imus, object of pity, man of scorn. And I, for one, am sorry. For Media Watch, this is Walter Cronkite. Thank you, and good night.
It's very nice, Walter.
Oh, drop dead, you jerk.
You know, it makes me laugh when people tell me I got the juice with the I-Man. They just don't know. Putting in everything I got in his cynical ass be shooting me down? Well, I'm here to tell him. You gone too far. You gone too far. You gone too far. Why you do? Grab your car, you gotta go. The I-Man's gotta go. Silly little show. I give my blood, but you probably want more. I'm putting up with your you childish little bitch. You gotta go. Yeah. 6 o'clock in the morning and you're ready. I'm on red. Can't take it no more. Listen up, man. Here, just to see yourself.
Where's Bernard? Don't leave the studio. Go look for a spoon. He's fired. That's what he is.
Yeah, I had to dip it in the toilet bowl before I threw it in.
Get out of this studio right now and go get it done.
Who do you think you're talking to?
Good. What the hell's the matter with you? Talk your way to the I-Man. What are you, nuts?
Chump better show some respect. Talk to the I-Man like that.
Angela shows up at 9 o'clock and can you find her?
No! Get in here! Get in here! Get out! Come in! Get out!
Gone too far! Gone too far! Gone too far! You deranged, egotistical sex!
He's gotta go! You're really sick. I was in the morning.
Scuttle here. One more word about your heart rate, and I think I'll open a vein.
Hey, I'm just king of rock and roll here, son. I've been dead now for, 20 years? And I still look better than you. You know what I'm saying, Hans?
Run around in fear. My little feet don't even hit the ground. One day you're up, and then the next one you're down. Give me menial jobs. Reduce me to rack and stop. You gotta go.
Fazio, head of production for the Imus Morning Program.
It's great. I love it. Yeah. I love it.
So our little weasel program director, Mark Chernoff, is here.
Why am I a weasel?
Because Bernard and Lou say they didn't come to you and whine about me jumping on them yesterday.
They did not. They did not come and complain.
Well, then Joel told me they did.
Well,
the manager of the
Renaissance. Maybe they whined to him. They did not whine to me. As a matter of fact, I went to Lou yesterday.
Yeah.
Lou will verify, and I said, make sure you hear 5:15 in the morning. No later than that.
He was here at 5:18. Well, what?
Punish him.
Well, no, but I mean...
All right,
the point is, you make these threats and you can't do anything about it, so...
Well, this is the first I heard
if
that
you're launching
at
the show, I mean, the news goes on at straight up, not 3 minutes after. I mean, I don't say... 3 minutes is a lot in radio time. That's my point, so...
Okay.
I just don't know. It just doesn't seem unreasonable to me.
Shall I dock him?
No.
Suspend him?
No.
See, what a great job he did yesterday putting that show together?
It's his job.
On short notice...
Yeah, you know why it was short notice? Because he wasn't here so I could tell him. That's why it was short notice.
Look who's here, Chuck.
Who's this one?
This one is Lauren Cooper.
Oh, man, Lauren, run.
Yeah, just look it out.
The door's over there. You can still make it.
So you're going to school now in Albany?
Yes.
With a B.A. in what?
Communication.
Another sucker.
Yeah.
The world's just waiting for you. There's plenty of opportunities out there.
Scary world, right?
Your radio sounds funny in the morning. You're listening to Imus in the morning.
Turner.
What's wrong with you?
What? I don't feel well.
You're clawing at your scalp. What?
I know.
What
does that
mean?
Head itches.
God.
That's scary.
Please.
That is scary.
The cramps.
You're an idiot.
This
I hate you.
They're climbing up your body.
Even his grams
ain't. Don't want to stay on him,
no.
Imus in the morning. Sports Radio 66 WFAU.
You want a free sample of something really great?
One, no question about it. The Jet Redskins were at Super Bowl. They could have won that game as well. 3 o'clock, we're coming back.
Mike and the Mad Dog, Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
All right, here now, the Imus Morning Program, Howard Stern. Good morning, Howard.
Yeah, how you doing, Howard?
How you doing, man?
Arlen Specter, that was riveting.
Well?
What a probing investigative interviewer you are. So, Arlen, do you think it's more difficult for you to run for president because you're a Jew? Hey, what's the deal with Pat Buchanan hating you because you're a Jew? It's not going to take long for Spector to figure out the only reason you have three testicles is because you got the one Hitler was missing.
If your radio light sucks in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
So, did the FBI take away your America Online account yet? Were you able to convince them that all those kiddie porn pictures were just models from Fred's new Calvin Klein-style catalog?
Imus in the Morning.
WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good afternoon. It is 3 o'clock. I'm Joe Tolleson. The Imus in the Morning 2020 Sports.
First down, Cowboys at the 31 of Minnesota. They'll keep it on the ground. Emmitt Smith with a lot of room. Emmitt Smith down the sidelines. Touchdown, Cowboys.
Dallas survives in overtime. Good morning. Mike Breen with Sports. Howard David, the call. Dallas wins in Minnesota 23-17.
Did you watch any of that game?
Bits and pieces?
I mean, they couldn't. Were you on an airplane flying from Detroit?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, well, they couldn't play it. I've never seen the Cowboys play that bad. They still won.
That's right. On the road.
Yeah.
It's a pretty decent Viking team.
I hate Minnesota, though. I hate Warren Moon, and I hate Minnesota, and I know how. I know we're on to Minneapolis-St. Paul, and I should be a big fan there.
Doesn't make any difference. You got to be proud of yourself.
You know.
They suck.
Yeah, they suck, and I'm glad they lost.
And Dallas, as you mentioned, didn't play well, but their coach, Barry Switzer, was still pleased with the intensity.
They played with a lot of emotion today!
Excitable coach, that Barry Switzer. Still has that college atmosphere, doesn't he?
All right.
How about the New York Jets win their first game of the year, beat Jacksonville 27-10 at the Meadowlands? Now, remember last week after the tough loss to the Colts, quarterback Boomer Esiason and radio analyst Dave Jennings got into it with this exchange.
What happened out there today?
We lost, Dave. Good question. Next.
Boomer, you sound pretty angry right now. Who are you angry at?
I think a little. Really, right now, I'm just angry at myself because we didn't win the football game.
Yeah, right. You suck.
What are you going to do about it?
Well, kick your ass. That's where I'm going to start.
Come back next week and play.
Yeah.
And get ready to go.
Yeah.
That's what we can do.
Where do you start?
I don't know.
All right, that's a very angry Boomer Esiason. So,
what?
Let's send it back upstairs. We tried our best down here.
Stupid questions. That's the thing. We already told Dave this.
Now, that was last week after the loss. This week, of course, Jennings and Esiason once again got together.
So, Boom, what happened out there today? This radio, Boomer, can you answer?
We won, Dave. Good question. Next.
Oh, that's really great.
Oh, what a difference a week makes.
I'm telling you.
Nice there.
It's Sam really getting along.
That's a little chuckle buck there.
Hey, Bernie, could you give me some more? We have an intern here today.
We have young Stephanie, who is bright and eager.
Okay, Stephanie, get me a cup of coffee, and do not let Bernard pee in it, okay?
That's enough of that.
One cup was fine.
It does not have two.
It's not that funny.
The incommunicable experience of war. We have felt, we still feel, the passion of life to its top. In our youth, our hearts were touched with fire.
I
Prince Precision Tennis Shoes, the first sports shoe made with a natural...
The world is an evil place, overrun with violence and destruction, filled with celebrities who butcher their own wives, then boldly proclaim their innocence to everyone, while they pay a dream team of other men to lie for them. Corrupt politicians who steal from the people with shady land deals, or expose themselves to innocent women, or stick their tongues down the throats of female co-workers. Pendejos, cabrones, hijos de puta, Democrats. In an evil world, it is easier to pull the trigger than play the guitar. Easier to destroy than to create. Easier to curse the darkness than to call someone a fat pantalone. That is why I must believe in the legend. The legend of a man who came out of the long shadows of the desert, riding across the mesa, uncommonly tall in the saddle. He was a manly man, one with a muy grande bulge in his trousers. They say he was born with the sign of the tree. Three testicles. When I was younger, there were many stories about this masked hero and his quest to find the man who killed his mother and raped his father. But after a while, those old wives' tales just faded away. There are some who say he was killed by the very one he sought to avenge. Others believe he met a beautiful woman, many years his junior, married her. They both now live with his brother in Santa Fe, making buffalo camisas for the gringo tourists. And then there are those who dismiss it all as just a myth, that he never existed at all. But I know better. I believe in the legend, because I have seen with my own eyes this very man, the man they call Tres Huevos.
Tres Huevos!
Again.
Out of the night comes a frightening sight. It's the man they call Tres Huevos. Tres Huevos. He's much better than you, for you only have two. The manly man they call Tres Huevos. Tres Huevos. One more than the average amount.
Imus in the Morning program, the return of Tres Huevos.
Tres Huevos.
All right, this is recorded live on the Bob Dylan Rolling Thunder tour. Kinky, paper.
We don't have no love in El Paso.
Beer!
Now, if you'll go over there to Pat Golf, you're listening to the I-Man on KROD there in El Paso. That's your kind of woman, Fred.
I'll tell you, you get her in a tight skirt, get her hair fixed up a little bit, some of them crotchless pantyhose.
Jesus, the tight skirt and the hair would have been fine.
Why did we have to go to
pantyhose? Why did we have to go to
what in the world?
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
You're a pig,
Fred. Some Lysol.
Yeah. Fly strip. Oh, come on. Jesus Christ, a no piss trip?
Oh man,
come on here.
Charles, you're not any help here. Sorry, I know.
Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
Why in the world?
You know, it's gone. I know Miami's done a good job first 2 weeks. You know what? They have one game to prove. They got to prove in the playoffs for me to believe that.
I know, but tonight someone takes a lead in the AFC.
Kinky's here to talk about his book. God bless John Wayne, his new novel from Simon & Schuster in bookstores everywhere. But he and Larry are going to appear tomorrow night at the Bottom Line with the Sons of the Pioneers.
True. Right, are we going to do this damn song or what, man?
Kinky wants to do.
The suppository's kicking in, man. I'm ready to roll.
Yeah, let's do that. The Ballad to Charles Texas Tower Whitman.
Sometimes I have problems with the lyrics of this. Retaining the lyrics.
Yeah,
Frank Sinatra. Many years.
It's kind of a Frank Sinatra thing. As Bernie just pointed out.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
What kind of hat is that? Is that a Stetson or a Reserve?
It's a big old expensive cowboy hat. Old boy bought me in Santa Fe.
It's a great hat.
Isn't it nice?
It's an 8X Beaver, which is...
No, it's a size.
I have a 20X Beaver.
Well, it's Madonna.
Imus in the Morning.
WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good afternoon. It's 3 o'clock. This is Ian Eagle.
2020 Sports. The 2-1 is line to deep right. It is high. It is far. It is gone. Oh, it's in play. And here's Mattingly the second. And he's going to be out.
Idiot. What a fool.
I guess the
moron. God, get out.
Right field wall. Mike is saying it did.
Yeah. The Yankees win in the Bronx.
Moron. He's what a jerk.
Minko, are you nervous?
No, I'm not.
Just relax.
I am.
It's not. It's radio. It doesn't mean anything. Yeah. It's just because it's on all over America.
What makes you think that I'm nervous?
Well, you look all wound up.
I am a little wound up.
Take a deep breath and just relax. God.
Make some more Valium in here.
What's that intern's name?
Mayaka.
Mayaka, give me a cup of coffee, would you please? Yankees pound the
Blue Jays.
Don't let Bernard pee in it.
Yankees pound the Blue Jays.
You know Bernard's been peeing on my coffee?
Really?
Yeah.
Why? It's a mystery.
Yanks pound the Blue Jays 9-2 in the Bronx, but they remain a game back in the wild card lead because Seattle won last night. As for the Yankee game, Wade Boggs had 2 hits, 2 RBIs. Boggs gave credit to the kid. At least that's what he calls him, the kid on the mound, David Cone.
He's maturing and growing.
Yes, he is. Growing from a boy to a young man. Yeah. Growing from being just a kid to a young man.
Fine.
That's exactly what he is today, a young man.
Uh-oh.
And that reminds me of a song.
Oh, no. Please don't sing,
my young man. There's a place you can go. I said, young man, when you're out on the go, go there. To the YMCA, they will start you back on your way. Bump, 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 bumpy bugs who stay at the YMCA. YMCA.
Shut up. God almighty, you've just humiliated yourself.
Absolutely not.
God almighty,
shows diversity.
Yeah, but you ought to just see. You ought to be able to see yourself.
I was wondering why I was wearing a construction hat this morning.
Yeah. You had on your war bonnet.
Yeah. Yankees and Blue Jays again tonight. Boston's magic number still 2.
All
they lose
right, time
all.
Out here. Could we get the intern to get me some hot coffee, maybe? How hard is this?
This is going to be the longest morning.
This is going to be a long morning for the intern.
God. See, that's where Bernard comes in.
It's naturally warm.
Jesus, God. Come on, Mike.
National League Colorado Rockies lead in the West. Now a game and a half. They beat San Diego 5-1 while the...
Yeah.
Fine. course, Lemire, the man who guided them to the Stanley Cup Championship last year.
It's 24 after the hour. It's time for more news. McCord is off today, as I told you, and Minko's here. He's got some OJ stuff. What's going on with that murdering goon?
Well, I'm as today's target in Los Angeles.
In the morning, flashback!
All right, here now on the Imus in the Morning program, the former heavyweight champion of the world, Iron Mike Tyson, with an ode to the Washington Post's Leonard Shapiro.
Yo, 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 what's up, boy? I am Mike, back with the mic in my hand. Got a message for all you juiceless wordsmiths. Well, I've been accused of being inflammatory by all of these PC punks who just looking to make a story. But they are the ones who should be apologizing for all of that boring rhetoric and liberal proselytizing. When all I was trying to do was give the president advice so Paula Corbin Jones wouldn't turn into Donna Rice. Bubba's got a reputation for acting hot to trot. Doing a 90s version of Camelot. Nah, suffice to say, my remarks are considered risque, causing Judy Woodruff a modicum of dismay. What all these bleeding heart columnists don't appear to know is that they aren't listening to your mother's morning show. They so uptight, stuck up, suck up till you chuck up, but sitting right beside you just waiting for you to screw up. So in retrospect, if you had asked me so, I should have laid up Paula Jones and pimp slapped Shapiro. Pimp slap the mo. For the nasty things he said, pimp slap the mo. Smack him upside the head, pimp slap the mo. Pimp slap the mo. Pimp slap the mo. Cause he said I wasn't chic, pimp slap the mo. For his hideous critique, pimp slap the mo. Cause he a journalistic geek, pimp slap the mo. Pimp slap the mo. Pimp slap the mo.
Leonard Shapiro in the fold now, here they are. I'm sorry for that. Sounds like a little Motown to me, don't you, baby? Talk to you about Prince Precision.